Okay, so we can continue. Maybe just a very practical thing is like be a little bit careful with your belongings, with your computers and so on, and maybe also try to wear your badges the whole time. And if you see people without badges, it's like let us know, people that you don't know. Sometimes, unfortunately, random people come in and out and try to grab computers. It has happened before. We have people that control the room, so I think the risk is low, but let's not kind of challenge faith. Okay, I think we are ready to move on. So as we said before, it's like today is the day to look at how to gather data, how to manage data, how to process data in order to get ready for modeling. And since we're also in the cardiovascular field, and that's one of the things that we do, we actually asked Mathieu de Crane here. He is actually one of the people which is also involved in the CardioFunction project that is partially kind of organizing this also. And Mathieu is background engineering, did a PhD in medical imaging, worked for a while here also, but currently is working in Philips Paris, in Philips Research Paris. So it's actually interesting to see a little bit the kind of industry perspective of this also, and where you see that real research is not only happening in academia, but is also happening in industry. And although industry, in the end, finally wants to make a product, in order to make products, of course, some more like a slightly more basic research is also needed. So it's very nice to have Mathieu to give us an overview on cardiac image analysis from the basics towards the industry, I hope. So please, thank you, Mathieu.
We'll see. Is the microphone working or not? Doesn't seem so.
It should be.
Is the microphone?
Yes.
Yeah, connected now. Okay. Yeah, so what I would like to do now is to take back a lot of things we have been seeing yesterday about the heart. And we had like the clinical point of view, the physiological point of view, but now take them back, but more from the perspective of image analysis. Actually, one thing I'd like to ask at least to Bart is to be quite interactive. So, I mean, of course, when we do quantification, we could get things wrong. That's very important to understand that well from the start. Because maybe we are not quantifying things accurately, so it could be that we get quantification errors because of a lot of noise in the image, because of bad processing, because too much regularization. But also it could be that the index we are quantifying is not very useful. So that's a bit what I would like to go over. It's, of course, a lot of very different things, so it means it will be like really more a tour, that really something very detailed. But I'd like to talk mostly about first how we can extract from images information regarding the anatomy. I have to go back. This is okay. So about the anatomy first, of course, the four chambers geometry, so the two ventricles, the atria, but also the coronaries that we've been talking a lot about yesterday. Also about fibers, because we saw a lot of beautiful images yesterday about fibers, but what about seeing this in real patients, and is it feasible or not? That's more for the anatomy, so the static part, but of course the heart moves, and so we want also to quantify this function. And the function of the heart, the main index that's quantified and used in practice is the motion and the strain, so we'll be talking about that, about what's global motion, what's how we can go from a global description to a final level. Very quickly, we'll talk about flow and perfusion, and I will finish by showing one example. That's actually, yes, it's a company example, you can say. It's one example, not in the sphere of diagnosis, but in the sphere of interventional imaging, about how image processing can be useful to merge information. So let's start with this first part about diagnosis, and let's start with the quantification of the four chambers of the heart. We have seen yesterday normal and pathological hearts, and you have seen that the heart can adapt in shape when there is a problem, being hypertension, being a valve that is not functioning. And we've seen that somehow, of course, there are a lot of possible variations, but the topology of the heart is quite consistent over subjects. You have deformations in terms of dilation, you will have thickening of the wall. This can be global, so global change in volume. They can be local, just the thickness of the wall. We have seen like basal septum, that's a typical typical signature of hypertrophy. But still, it's quite a consistent geometry. And so that means that from the side of image processing, what's been mainly done is to take a model of the heart, so that's sometimes called an atlas, and to map this very generic average model to each patient. Of course, when we do this, there are like three questions that will arise. Honestly, the first one is more, I would say, a hobby for image processing people. It had a lot of interest some years ago, and I think it's progressively disappearing, but it's how do you get the average anatomy? What's an average? Then when you want to take this average to an image, the question is, how can you very grossly estimate what the heart is? Sometimes in an MR in a CT, you have a lot of things around. You want to get a bounding box around the heart. And then how do you do really the refinements or the adjustments to the heart? So that's about the how to obtain an average anatomy. It's actually some research that's been done in UPF, so that's why it's nice mentioning it. Where mostly what's involved here is a lot of registration, so image registration. So you try to align images from different subjects. And what's done in to get an average that's not too biased to the choice of one specific subject, what you do is that you start to pick up one subject in the database, you align everything to it. And then you can average these aligned images, and I haven't tried the pointer yet, let's see. And you would get something like this, that's a blurry image that, of course, looks very much like your reference because you've been aligning everything to this reference. So we say that there is bias in this average. And to remove the bias, you can also take all the transformations, because what's interesting in this procedure is not so much the final image that you get, but it's actually all the set of transformations that map every subject to this reference. And that's where there is information about the variability in the data set. And so you can also take the average of this transformation and apply it to this averaged image. And that's a way to remove bias. And of course, you can do that iteratively to get to remove progressively the bias that was in your initial choice of reference. And you see that in the red circle here, I put something about log. This is just to mention that when we do statistics on deformation, you need to be careful between quotes. Because, for instance, if you take the vector fields associated to rotations and you just average them, you might get something then that's not the average rotation. And so you need, so there are some mathematical tools that are this log and exponential that are operations you do on a vector field to somehow scale it down in a space where you can do averages, and then you can come back and avoid some artifacts that actually come when you do statistics on big deformation. Then our second question is how to localize the heart. So here you have like two possibilities. The first one on the top is really, really common, so I mention it because it's actually what's in the Philips product, so I think it's worth mentioning. Is this idea of the generalized Hough transform. So the idea is simply that if you take your reference shape, you may index, so you can go along your shape, and you can look at the normal of the contour. And for each value of this normal, you can build a lookup table. That's the table you have on the right there, where for each orientation, you store the direction of the center of the shape. And now, when you want to find this same shape in an image, what you do is that you run an edge detector. You will get normals by looking at the gradient. And you can use your table, that's kind of your representation of the shape, to look at directions, and this is like a voting approach. So in this direction, on the image, you will count and you will get a vote for each voxel. And so you increment on the ray that goes from the point in the direction of the normal. So in this ray, you increment the vote of all points. And of course, when you do that for all the points of the shape, then the one that should get the most votes is the center. So it's quite a robust way to detect a center in a shape, and it's called the voting-based approach. Of course, you don't have to do that. There are many other possibilities. So I just put another one there, which is more based on registration, where also you detect some key points. And then you can take just like an average shape that's been computed from a set of images. And because if we take a four-chamber view like this, the heart is more or less always in the same place. This is already a good estimate. And sometimes it's sufficient to then deform to the heart and detect the heart like this. Then, of course, there is a lot to do to take this generic shape and align it with a good level of details to the image. And that's where it's interesting to talk about point distribution models. So this is often referred to as PDM. Typically, these point distributions are computed using a PCA, which is a very standard tool in machine learning. I would say it's the first one of the toolkit somehow. And so the idea is you build a matrix of covariance about all the points in the shape, and you try to diagonalize this matrix. So you will come up with eigenvectors that you store in a matrix that's called here phi. And then what's important is that what you can do is, if you take an input shape being x, you subtract the mean, because that's very important. It's always a way to center your data. And I'm sure Gemma will agree that no matter what you do in machine learning, it's important to normalize the data before. And it's not always easy. So the simplest normalization is to subtract the mean. So you take your shape, you subtract the mean, and when you project it on the eigenvector, so this phi matrix, you get a vector of coordinates. So that's a very simple way, and it's really the simplest one, but to take a shape as input and to project it in a space that has no real physical meaning, but where you have a set of coordinates, and every of your shape is mapped as a point. And that's very interesting, because it's a way, conceptually, to get a big population of shapes and to map it to a space where you just have points. But then you can navigate into there, you can click, and you can view the associated shape. So I think it's very interesting, at least it's something I have interest in, to develop navigation tools in databases when you have a lot of subjects. And then you can come back, so it means that from this coordinate, you can always reconstruct a shape just using exactly the same phi matrix. It's the same matrix to project and to come back. So this means that in the context of segmentation, what we have here actually is a deformation, a transformation model, because I can formulate the problem of segmentation like I want to find the optimal B values to fit my image. Okay, so that's a way to deform this very generic mean and to use not only the average, which is not the most interesting part of the atlas, but all the statistical information that's included in my atlas. And often, this is not enough, so it's often combined with simpler transformations, so just geometric transformations. Of course, then you use this transformation as a regularization, so what's typically done is for every point of the surface, you look on the normal, you find the closest edge in the image, and you get a displacement. That's very noisy, of course, because you could get a lot of errors in this process. But because we have this transformation model, that's some kind of statistical regularization, we can regularize all these very noisy displacements, and we can deform the heart to the best possible fit in the image. So now I have a video of, I don't know if there should be sound, but it's not really important anyway, because the sound is not. But that's the promotional material for this heart model. Oh yeah, that's me. It was my fault. So these are all the concepts we have seen, but you see them working on images. So this is this average image that's been deforming to the patient specific geometry. Really a marketing video, so hope you don't know. But this motion is artistic. So Okay, so you see that these concepts that are research concepts, having, I think it's looping, so I will stop. Having been developed in universities, they now are part of a project. And I think it's an interesting example. No, Bart will tell you if that's useful or not. It's a completely different story. Okay, just to mention, here I was a bit biased because, as Bart said, I was at UPF, then no Philip, so I saw a lot of these model-based segmentation. There are other methods, I would say more traditional in the image processing community, like the level set-based. and that's actually a nice example. It's done at Creatis by Olivier Bernard in collaboration with Leuven. It's a level set method, so I don't know if you're familiar with what a level set is. But it's a way to represent a surface. So typically when you want to extract an object in an image, it means somehow you want to express one coordinate. So let's say this x1, that would be the first of your coordinates as a function of the others. And so because this is a function, you may represent that in different way. And here, one way they've used is to use it as using a sum of basis functions that are radial basis function. What's interesting is that they did it in a space of coordinate that's spherical. And I put it here just to mention that sometimes the physical space, let's say XYZ, is not the best space to represent the shape. So we'll discuss about that again when we see strain. But so here, clearly it made more sense because the surface we are representing is topologically quite close to a sphere. You could deform a sphere to get there. It makes more sense to use this space of coordinates that's well adapted to the geometry of the problem. And then they're actually using some quite classical level set thing. So you minimize a functional where it's actually a sum between an inside energy, so inside the contour and outside the contour. And each energy is like the variance, so trying to get an intensity that's as constant as possible inside the contour. But it works quite well, and they managed to apply that quite quickly because they have this representation uses basis function that speeds up things quite a lot. So this was for the geometry, like the four chambers. But of course, yesterday we saw also a lot about the coronaries. And we see how this is really important to look at which part of the myocardium could not be getting the right level of oxygen. So you want to quantify from the image processing point of view if there is a stenosis in the coronary tree. But first, you want to reconstruct it. And so this is like, again, one example. You have the references there, where what they needed to do is to define a lot of seed points in the image. And then they try to connect the dots. So they try to connect these seed points by having, again, a level set. So it's the same thing we just saw. But here it's the idea of a front that propagates from a starting seed point to an end seed point. Again, it's optimizing some energy, so I will spare you the details. But what's interesting in this type of segmentation problem is that sometimes you might get stuck and just not reach the final seed point. So to make it more robust, you need to consider a lot of hypotheses. And what actually they were able to do in all these works is to have a framework that is testing for different combinations of parameters and then choose the best one. And I think that's quite an interesting concept for us. To say that sometimes we should not restrict ourselves just to one processing, but we should be running different tests and be able to fuse them and to take the best. So that's also a concept that's now getting more and more generic in image processing. And it was already there. So then the idea, when you get your, of course, you can do that in two iterations. So it's what you see on the left. You see that first they estimate a center line. That's actually a bit wrong. But then they can correct it by estimating the radius. So you can go in a multi-scale approach. And then what's typically done is once you have your coronary reconstructed, you can unfold the image along this coronary. And you get like just this straight image on the right. And that's the image where they look at if you have any calcifications. Then yesterday we had Marta telling us quite a lot about perfusion, and she mentioned SPECT. She also mentioned ultrasound. If you remember, these are the bubbles. But she also was quite careful about how useful this is. She also said that MR is a new modality to look at that, or it's like an alternative at least. So the idea there is that you will inject contrast. It's typically gadolinium. And you will look at the contrast uptake. And so you see that, of course, the cavity are appearing very bright first. But what you are actually interested in is to look at the contrast evolution inside the myocardium. And of course, that's a very, very challenging problem on the image processing side, because these images are taken while the patient is breathing. So there is a lot of motion. Also, it's very noisy data because they want to do a sequence that's really continuous. So they cannot take a lot of cardiac cycles and average them to reduce the noise. And so that means that you need to do first the first alignment of all these images to compensate for the breathing. So that's already a tough registration problem. Then you also want to segment each of these images because you want to look at the contrast uptake in the muscle. And so then they try to have this type of curves to quantify the parameters that you see there. So this delta in time, in intensity. And they try to fit typically some models, so some typical distribution models to this. Now, a variation of that is called the SCAR, so the late enhancement, sorry, to quantify SCAR. So there it means you wait a much longer time. And you have sequences in MR that are designed so that the scar tissue that's really fibrotic will appear as bright. So if you look on the top left images, you see all the regions that are shown by arrows and that are very bright, they designate where the scar is. This, again, is quite challenging data to process, but it's very interesting because when you look at patients with ischemia, that's where you know which part of the tissue is truly damaged. And so you can confront this to what you would see in ultrasound, which is the motion. Okay. So this is typically an information that's very difficult to access in clinical practice. So what Marta was saying yesterday is that all patients get ultrasound, but very few of them get MR. And this is something that we would like to be able to see on ultrasound. But currently, pitifully, the reference is MR. So in terms of processing, what's typically done is, because these images are also very noisy and they don't have a very good resolution, they are complemented by another sequence that's a Cine loop, which is the usual sequence any patient would get when they go for a cardiac MR. And so there you get a first segmentation that's matched on these late enhancement images. So it means that, again, first you try to extract the contours, and then once you know where to look at, you try to do some thresholding. It can be based on graph cuts. There are many possible techniques. But then the processing is quite simple because you know that you just look for the bright tissue and you would like to discriminate the different areas in the myocardium, specifically looking at what's called the transmurality. So what's important to know in this heart is if the infarct is going from the endocardium to the epicardium or if it's just a small part, and that there is still like half of the thickness that's preserved and that can function. And then let's just say a word about fibers. Fibers are very difficult to get from real images. So it's very difficult to get for one specific patient the architecture of fibers. So we have seen yesterday how important this is to explain a lot of things about deformation. If you remember Bart doing his Egyptian figure like this. The fact that you go from endocardium to epicardium with a change of orientation, and the fact that because the fibers are mostly longitudinal at the endocardium, it means that when things go wrong, longitudinal function is first penalized. So this all means that fibers are a very important information that we would like to get for patients. But the fact is that getting sequences, MR sequences to image that is very challenging in vivo. So there's been a lot done on ex vivo data, but that's not really interesting to apply it to patients. It's not too bad because you can do statistics and you can take a statistical model to map it on the patient and then do your simulation. But it means that your simulation is using for the fibers. That's really a key component of the simulation, something that's really an approximation and something that's not really specific to the patient. So it's important to try to develop these techniques in vivo, and that's why there is a lot of MR research on that. And if you see the reference on the bottom, it's these are people trying to take these sequences that take hours, really, of acquisition and try to get them on a patient in vivo with breathing, heart beating. So they have to, they have a very small temporal window in which acquire data. And it's all about optimizing the MR sequence for this problem, but also how to do regularization afterwards, because you'd like to keep all the information, but you know that you will get very noisy data. So you need to regularize. And more you see that the ultrasound is a fascinating modality because it's changing a lot over these years. And more specifically, there is like a revolution in ultrasound that is called this shear wave imaging. I'm not a specialist about acquisition, so I will try to put it in simple words and you correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it's like if you had a very tiny seismic wave in the heart, in the tissue that you are imaging, and you manage to generate this shock wave by ultrasound, and then you try to image how this wave is advancing in the tissue. And if you look at the velocity of this wave, it gives information about the elasticity. And more, they are trying to extend this. Of course, again, it's one thing is to acquire this type of information on a static piece of tissue. Something else is to acquire it inside the heart. And so that's really two different problems. But in terms of anisotropy, so to estimate this orientation of the fibers, there are no imaging techniques that are like considering different shear waves, trying to combine them. And you see that they are already able to reproduce something we saw yesterday about this change of orientation from endo to epi. So you get similar distributions, although the numbers are not exactly the same, between echo and DTI. So I think that's a very positive thing, because if that can be later applied to patients, that could be an alternative to the MR techniques, so this diffusion tensor imaging that's been there for years, but very difficult to apply to the heart. Okay, then we've seen a lot about anatomy. Now I would like to say a few words about the motion. And we will go progressively from very global features to more local ones. So the first feature that you want to quantify from a heart, of course, is the volume over time. So you get here the typical volume curve. If you get this volume, you have a direct index that you obtain from it. That's called ejection fraction. That's one of the first index that's still used in clinical practice. They always look at it. So at least it's my feeling, from what I hear also from people in Philips working in clinics, they always compute it. Now, it's not a great measure, and Bart could talk hours about why it's not a great measure, but it's the first measure. And so to quantify a volume, how do we do that from an image processing point of view? Well, the way we do it at my lab, at least, there are other ways, but it's, we have a way to represent a shape where you see that you take the, so this is called the long axis of the ventricle. And from this axis, you can cast a lot of rays, and you can measure the distances to the surface of the left ventricle. So you see that we combine like a cylindrical representation with a spherical one. And all the points that you get in this way are nicely and neatly arranged already by something that's called longitudinal and circumferential indexes. Okay. And so, of course, if you take all these small elements of volume, you can sum them up and you can compute a volume. So that's how we do it. And that's how we reconstruct from a typical 3D ultrasound that you see there, a volume curve. Of course, if you have only two views, it's important to know that in clinics, they also often estimate volumes just with 2D views. But the idea is the same. You can just interpolate the information where you have got it. So even if it's just in two planes, you interpolate somehow to the rest of the shape. So this was for volume. Now, okay, yes, it moves. Now let's talk about another measure that was also mentioned yesterday, that's called strain. So there are many complex ways to define strain, but I'm not going to go for the complex way. I've had a lot of discussions in practice. Anytime you talk about a mechanical engineer with strain, it's a nightmare because you have a 2 hours discussion about which strain definition you are using. So here I'm going to use the dummiest one, that's called engineering strain. And it's the relative change of length. So here we just define strain as a one-dimensional measure, where you compare this small L, that would be the length after deformation, to the big, to the capital L, that's the length before deformation, and you see that it's normalized. And so the first thing you can do when you're looking at the left ventricle is to take lengths that go over the entire extent of the shape. So you see that on the top, we've been drawing, let's say, strings that go from the apex, so the point, to the base. And of course, if you track this, so it's a bit similar to what was done for the volume curve, but now let's imagine that we are not only quantifying the envelope, but we are also able to track points. It means that you can compute this length of every of these strings. You can compute this E value, so you can come up with a set of values that represent, on the top, it would be the global longitudinal deformation. And so that's something known as a GLS, which is also one number. So because, OK, you have a value for all the strings, but you can average this or take the median value if you want. And this value, so this global longitudinal strain, GLS, has been used a lot as ejection fraction to be an index to differentiate healthy subjects from pathological. It's not magic, neither is the ejection fraction. So there is also a lot of limitations to this. But it's slightly better than ejection fraction because, as we saw yesterday, longitudinal function is first penalized when there is a problem. And so it appears to be a little bit more sensitive than ejection fraction. So of course, this was set for longitudinal strings. But if you take circumferential one, I'm not going to manage to say it, but it doesn't matter. So you make circles from also base to apex. You can also look at these length changes. And you will get this global circ strain. So what we've been introducing already in the former slides is this idea that you can map the ventricle to a 2D map. So this is some type of flattening. And what you see on the top, this circle is the most usual flattening that any cardiologist is used to read a lot. So the idea is that the center shows the apex. The outer circle represents the base, so it would be there is no notes, but I will try to. So really, this top circle here. And of course, all the intermediate circles are going from base to apex like that. And it's usual to divide this in 17 segments. There are different definitions from segments. this one is the most usual. What Bart will surely tell you is that this is a very artificial decomposition. OK, so they just decided to divide it in territories like this because it was easy. It doesn't exactly match the perfusion territories of the coronaries. You can put a map of the territories on this circle, but it's not going to exactly cross the borders of the segments. But still, it's a representation that's used a lot. And just what I wanted to mention is that what we saw about the global strain in the previous slides, we can do it at different levels here. So all these strings that are horizontal and vertical here, I can apply the same computation of the strain. So I can get a strain value per segment or even per point. Now, frankly, we don't have the resolution to go per point. But. So we've been talking about tracking, but I didn't give details about this yet. So this is this comes from a paper where I participated. We wanted to compare different tracking techniques. And here you have the list of the techniques that were compared. And I think it's just good to mention it because it gives an example of the type of technique. So you see words like elastic image registration, optical flow, block matching. These are different types of tracking techniques. You also see that some of them are labeled as working on the B-mode data. That means they work on the final image. So that's the typical processing that knows nothing about the acquisition and works really on the final image. And you see also that there is here one working on our RF data. So this is before the image. Actually, these ultrasound signals, they are signals being sent at very high frequency. And if you can access them, you can also like do your tracking on this very high frequency signal and trying to do the matching based on these signals rather than on the image. The image being an envelope of this signal. So this is just to go with, I'm not going to go into much details now. We will see with further details for the tag demo the same type of tracking techniques. But what we have is typically an elastic registration. What it means is you put what they call control points. So it means you take points of interest, or sometimes they are just a regular grid of points, and you put basis function of every point, and you optimize this. And you try to maximize the fitting between images to estimate a longitudinal transformation, so to do the tracking. You see that some people here are also doing this approach, but they do it, again, in a flattened representation of the ventricle. So it means they take the input image, and they wrap it to this image, which is actually the unfold of the ventricle. So the unfolding concept we have seen before is now applied to the images themselves prior to the tracking. Then you have optical flow, which is, I think, it's one of the oldest image processing algorithms. So you could lecture about it for us. But the idea is that you compute, you don't have really basis function. You try to compute what's called a dense displacement field. So for every point, you look for a displacement value, so three numbers. So it's a very big object that you are trying to compute here. And to regularize, you typically do Gaussian smoothing, and you do iteratively. And mathematically, the first one typically optimizes a cost function, and it's like traditional optimization techniques where you compute derivatives. And the second one, it's doing the same, but on the variational point of view. So it's kind of another branch of optimization. But of course, they are very connected. And the last one is really block matching. So that's the one where you just take a small block around your point of interest, and very locally, you try to look for how this block is moving to the next frame. Again, either in the B mode or the RF image. Then that's the speckle tracking. Bart would tell you that this is rubbish, because as we have seen, there is regularization in there. You need to put some regularization, otherwise you just get crazy things. But another way to get strain is also by looking at Doppler. Doppler is giving you velocities. So it means that if you do an integration, you can get back to the strain rate and then to the strain. Okay, so by integrating velocities, you can get the same information. Of course, because it's based on velocities, there is not so much regularization. And so this is an example where you see that some temporal patterns are not well visible here on the speckle tracking, but they are more visible on the Doppler. So it's an alternative. So you have to know that there are two different techniques and that they can be complementary. Just a word about desynchrony. Desynchrony is a very nice example of a lot of indexes that you can compute from images because we have seen tracking. So it means that now you can start to trace curves that represent strain or velocity and compare these curves at different locations in the ventricle. And you can compute a lot of indexes. One of them being that you know that the normal heart contracts synchronously. So all the peaks should be properly aligned. While pathological hearts, you will start to see some dispersion. And so you could look at this distance between the peaks. Now, it turns out that if you just get numbers out of this, it's very difficult to get a reliable index. And I think this is an example, but where it actually means that the next step is that we don't just want to get a number. We want to get a pattern. And that's where I'm setting up the stage for Gemma and the machine learning. That's where we have to evolve from just computing a single number being ejection fraction, GLS, and we have to recognize more complex things, which is a trend in your data. Okay, now I will say some words about stacked MR, because I think it's very interesting for the image, from the image processing perspective. Of course, clinically, you could say the interest is a bit limited, because as we saw in many times, you only have ultrasound images. But what we are trying to do in the lab I'm working is comparing actually the ultrasound and the tagging to validate the ultrasound. So these tagged images, what are they? They are images produced by imposing this pattern in the magnetization. So you see that you manage to have like bands that are much brighter. And this is like following the tissue. So you will see them deforming with the tissue. So it's a bit a dream because you have like a lot of markers in your image and you can track it. And this is something you don't have as well defined, at least in an ultrasound image. And something that's also very interesting is you see that you can apply these tags in different directions. So you can have like different channels to your input signal. So against the tracking methods, if you look at them, they are very similar to what we saw in ultrasound. So the first one, the elastic registration, I consider it is déjà vu. So I'm not going to talk it about more, but it's exactly the same concept. So this is a typical example of people just use exactly the same technique and they apply it as it is to another modality. So there is really no change in the algorithm. But then what's very interesting in this modality is you have a lot of techniques that are actually really tailored and adapted for the specificities of this acquisition. So the first one is called HARP. It's actually the first processing technique that was proposed. And it's still taken often as a gold standard for strain. I would be a bit careful with it, because what they do is actually, to put it in very simple words, what I'm doing here is a bit of a caricature, but I think it can be useful, is that they do a tracking without any regularization. And so, of course, when you compute strain from there, if you look what the tracking looks on real images, you have points that go completely out of the field of interest. They go completely crazy, and your strain, which is this change in length, is going completely crazy as well. So I would say good luck if you really use this image processing tool as such, because having no regularization is really too optimistic. I mean, you have too much noise in the data to be able to do that. Then you have some other techniques that are really looking, and we will now see them in more details, but they are really trying to do an analysis either in frequency, or you will also see that the last one is actually a bit of a I think that their starting point was to say really that tracking is rubbish, in the sense there is too much regularization. So they really tried to get rid of the tracking. So let's go one by one. So the historic one, it's called HARP. So the first step is a pre-processing step. They compute what they call phase images. And that's because initially the tagging image had what's called tag fading. So these tags that they were imposing on the tissue were not persistent. And so the intensity was progressively going down, and the tags were disappearing. So it's very difficult for the tracking, because if you look for the same intensity, you'll get wrong tracking results. So they needed to extract something that's not sensitive to this change of intensity. And what they did is to extract the phase, which is a really common tool in image processing. And it's also used a lot in ultrasound. And for here, because we don't have much time, let's just look at this as a way to go from the intensity to an image that's normalized between, let's say, minus pi and pi. Then they do tracking. So that's still the original HARP algorithm. And what you see here, if you have done optical flow, you would recognize that this is an optical flow equation. But there is a big difference that this, what you are tracking is not a vector. So rather than having one channel, you have actually three channels, because each channel is one direction of acquisition. So the vertical tags, the horizontal, and the perpendicular ones. And so normally in optical flow, you have a problem that's referred to as aperture problem, which means that you cannot estimate with just one channel a 2D vector field or 3D vector field. But by adding channels, you can. So this is really what's interesting in this modality. So then what we did is we re-implemented this technique for 3D images, but what Yitian did, and he's sitting there when he's not visiting the Sagrada Familia, but is that we try to do some regularization because you need to. And what you see is that we put basis function, but we were inspired by what we saw before of not using the XYZ space, but a more anatomical space, we call it. So we divide the ventricle into patches. And there we try to compute a local system of coordinates. That's the radial longitudinal circumferential direction that we've been talking about in strain. And we try to express the transformation as a linear transformation, so an affine transformation in this space. Here it was our first version that was using a diagonal matrix, but then we improved it and made the matrix being any affine matrix. And yeah, I hope the videos will play. But this is some example of tracking results. It might be a bit heavy, so it could be that it takes some time. I'm not going to touch PowerPoint right now because it could be. Well, if it doesn't launch, we'll have to skip. It's a pity. But it's to see these images in motion. But if you're interested, I can show you afterwards on my computer. Then you have like another processing technique that's called SynMod. And that's really interesting because it's exploiting some properties of really a Fourier transform. So which is that the fundamental property is that if you have a shift in a signal in space, it gives a phase difference in the Fourier domain. And so you can use this property to actually what they do is they go to the frequency domain, they apply low pass and high pass filters. And what you see appearing in the equations is that they've like, yeah, it's difficult to read it here, but you see that there is the conjugate of image one versus image two. And so this is to make appearing the phase difference. And this phase difference, that's this arc of PCC, which is this reply to the filter, you see that they normalize it by a spatial frequency, which I think is a very interesting concept because it means you see appearing in the image the notion of the spatial frequency, so how many tags are there at this point in the image. And then you have these guys, and I like all these approaches because I think they're very complementary and they say a lot about typical problems in image processing. They said, okay, in everything that we have seen up to now, you need a regularization. And sometimes we don't like that because it means that we could miss, if the part that's contracting abnormally is very small, we could miss it completely. And so these ones, what they said is, let's go really to the image and let's consider that if this was attacked before deformation and this is after deformation, I can directly measure difference in angles and differences in lengths. And this is like a direct estimate of strain. Of course, the problem is that when you are like too monolithic, is that they miss a point, which is that for any application, you want to follow one material point and you want to see its deformation curve over time. So you will still need tracking. And that's typically something they overlook. But it's very interesting because it means that sometimes you need to combine different tools. And that maybe tracking is not the best way to compute strain, but it's still useful to make sure you are following the same material point in the image. Then I'm going to say, but very quickly, because I think time is running, I'm going to say a word about validation. Because a big problem in image processing always is we've seen about getting beautiful information from images, anatomy, function. But the question is, of course, I can give you curves, but how do you know that this is accurate? And more specifically for tracking, it's a bit of a nightmare. So already when you want to validate segmentation, what's been done a lot in the field is to do manual segmentation by different people. And it's a very, very painful task. So these people really do you a favor because it means they have to contour the images manually. And you want to do that several times per observer, and you want different observers to have an idea of the variability of this so-called ground truth. So it's really a nightmare to do. Now, that was for segmentation. If we want to apply this to tracking, it's even worse because when you have a 3D image, even like a very simple phantom image as we have here, so this is like a physical object that's a cylinder and it's deforming through a pump and it's imaged in the MR. I mean, you could manually trace points, but it's extremely difficult. And you will have a lot of noise and inaccuracies in this process. So what can we do about it? What's typically done is to combine solutions. So you see that on the top, the first one is to take, as I mentioned already, you take images from a patient. You take different modalities. And of course, you will quantify them differently. You will get different results. But if they are consistent, somehow you will be confident that this was the right value. Of course, it's thought to be really an accuracy measurement that's really quantified in millimeters. So then people started to say, no, we need something else. So another way, still to be very close to the imaging modality, is to do what's called in vivo animal experiments. And so these are these experiments where you take an animal and the poor thing, you like block a coronary artery and you look at the effect. So we saw this type of images yesterday. Okay, and of course then you know, because you control exactly, you know that you have been pinching a certain coronary, so it corresponds to this sector in the myocardium, and you can check that your quantification indeed shows a difference in the baseline and in after infarction in this part. But again, that's very difficult to get measurements that are really detailed and that are, so you will typically get measurements at spare points, so you don't really get accuracy measures on the entire geometry. Then you see the phantoms, which are these toy objects. So they somehow represent the shape. Here you see something that grossly looks like a left ventricle. And you couple it to a pump, but of course, you don't really get the same motion patterns. And when you put that inside an ultrasound machine or an MR, you get an image that looks real in the sense this is the real modality. But it's too easy compared to a real image. And then also what's now more and more done is to do simulation. And that's an interesting application because we are in the context of VPH, where you try to simulate everything. So you simulate both the imaging device and the motion fields, which is actually what I will present here. So here you see that these are different types of synthetic images because we've been working a lot on this. And on the left, you see the first type of images where you have a very simple ultrasound model, a very simple geometry. And of course, you can validate your segmentation and your tracking on this. But this doesn't look realistic. So it means if you quantify your accuracy on this, it doesn't tell you a lot about what's really the performance of your algorithm. And then you see that we've been trying to improve them. And now what we are doing is to mix reality and simulation, which is the one on the right. So that you get images that are hopefully more and more realistic. And we think this is a good way to verify the accuracy of algorithms before putting them into hospitals. The context for this is that, of course, doctors realize that if they take different software from different vendors, they get completely different values. And this more and more is making people very unhappy, and I think it's really understandable. So that's why we need this type of benchmarking data sets. And I think that modeling is a way to make this type of validation data sets. I will skip this. Just this is like the general thing you want to do. You combine all these modeling techniques. You extract from the simulation that this, you see this mesh, so it's completely, it's a modeling result. There is nothing that comes from a real image in there, but you can get all the indexes you would like to quantify, so all the strains, the motion, possibly the torsion that we mentioned yesterday too. And then you take this simulation result, you put it in another model that will mimic the ultrasound device. We also do there the blending with a real image so that we get things more realistic. You quantify these synthetic images, you get your quantification results, and because you did the mechanical modeling, you can compare exactly. And for every pump, which is something that we cannot typically do in the other types of validation strategies that we have seen. Just very briefly a word about flow. I think this is a developing field, and again, ultrasound can bring a lot of information. So I've been presenting speckle tracking techniques, but you have seen that ultrasound has much more than that. There is all the Doppler traces, and more specifically at the valves, you get these color Doppler, these pulsed Doppler traces that give velocity traces. And I think they contain a lot of information. Also, it was mentioned by Marta, so it's interesting because I had it also in my slides, but you see that they now want to look more at, if you see this color image, and you can really look at a gradient from base to apex. And we want to see, a lot of people want to see how this correlates with some other indexes that are maybe much more complicated to compute. So that's very interesting because flow could give access to indexes that are equivalent or better than others that are already existing. And yeah, again, that should be a movie, but considering how the previous one was playing. Now this one works. So you, what you see in this image is that it's the standard image acquired by the EPIC device, so it's the last generation of Philips ultrasound. But what you start to see is, so we had a doctor, so Eric Salou. He came back to us extremely excited because he started to see in the cavity things, so pawns that are moving. And this is really cool because if we can track this, it means we can have an image of the flow. And you have people already doing simulation of that, so what you have on the right is this Gao et al. Paper where they try to generate, it's a bit like what we saw for the validation. So they run a simulation, a flow simulation. So they get all these beautiful vector fields of flow. That's actually the middle column here. And then they generate synthetic ultrasound. They quantify them, and they want to see if they can recover the flow. Okay, and you see that this is more and more appearing. There is something called B-flow that's also appearing in products. So it means that this is something that will progressively, I think, gain interest. And I think it's really nice because we were working a lot about shape, about motion. But getting the detailed flow patterns inside the cavity could reveal a lot. And of course, you can get the same type of information from MR images. Of course, exactly as we have seen before, it's very interesting to get it from ultrasound because that's something we could do potentially in all patients. But it means that we also we will be able to run comparisons to check if what we estimate is correct or not. And then just to finish this talk, we have been talking a lot about diagnosis, but I'd like to really step out of this and say a word about interventional. Interventional image processing in cardiology, I think it deserves another talk, really, because it's really another field. They work a lot on X-ray images, which are 2D images, that are very, very difficult images because you see a projection of everything. So it's just in the talk we saw before, you have this Radon transform, no? So this idea that you will, here with the X-ray, you will get a projection, and you rotate your arm, so it means that you will get a set of projections. Or you just leave it fixed, and it means that in these projections, you will get a lot of overlay between the objects. And there, what you want to do is to do tracking of the tools, detection, and you want, of course, to locate yourself. So the physicians would like to know if he's deploying a valve, where he is exactly. And that's where different modalities can bring different type of information. So the X-ray is really the modality used in interventional imaging, but now more and more, they are trying to acquire ultrasound images at the same time. And the ones they go for in this case are the transesophageal images. So it's what Marta mentioned yesterday. If you remember the guy who is swallowing the probe, so there are these type of images. And the question is, how do you fuse them? Because you will see things in the ultrasound, you will see things in the X-ray, but if you have to get the mental picture of what's really going on and make the integration while operating the patient, this is just too much. So as image processing people, we need to bring solutions to match these two things and to present them in an integrated way. And so that's actually an example where you see the modality. So what you see is that in the X-ray image that's on the left, you see actually the ultrasound probe. And so here in this image processing technique, what's actually done is that from the probe as seen from the X-ray, you can estimate where the probe is located. And so it means that if you are able to detect the probe in the X-ray, and if you have, again, a table of all the possible orientation of the probe, and if by looking at the images you can say this is the current orientation, you can really detect the probe in space, and you can align and turn the ultrasound image accordingly.
Technology helps you understand how the devices and the anatomy are interacting. And here you see how the septum bulges, where it is coming across, what the trajectory is. You can't do that in 2D. You just can't put that together in your mind the same way.
So that's a very interesting example where, as we have seen before, different modalities will interact together and we have to merge them. And really, I think interventional imaging is going through a lot of changes now. So it's going to evolve and not to be X-ray based anymore. And actually, the Philips unit that used to be called X-ray, now it's actually called interventional, because they don't want to define themselves anymore by the modality, but they want to define themselves by the fact that they do imaging in the context of intervention. And that's really an evolution in the business. And so just I have two final slides to talk about perspectives. And actually, what I wanted to do here is to make a link between what we have seen yesterday and today, and what you will see in the coming, in the next presentation, actually, and in the next day. So first of all, machine learning. You might know that there is a big evolution happening in the image processing field. Something called this deep convolutional network, deep learning, that's been, it's really like a wave. So it's smashing everything. It's a tsunami. So in image processing conferences, you see more and more submissions on this. Oscar was telling me the other day that last year, you were seeing this type of work at the workshop, so kind of the satellite event of the conference. And now in the main conference, it's appearing everywhere. So it's really a change in the way to do image processing, really based on data rather than models. So I've started this talk by showing a model deformed on an image. That was the heart model-based segmentation. Here, the idea is really we don't want to have a model. We want to infer the model or the features from the data. And that's why I call them no-sweat features, is just to mention that. This is not only happening in the medical field. We are a bit behind as usual. But like, for instance, there are people that took Photoshop. They took all the filters in Photoshop, and they tried to, of course, they apply them to many images. So that's a huge set of data that they can feed to a learning algorithm. And they try to replicate the filter with a convolution, with this type of deep learning technique. And they can replicate any of the Photoshop filter. Okay. And so they can make a very cheap Photoshop. So it means that you have people working on features like image processing, computing phase, gradients, denoising, trying to do filter design. So it's really the old way. And so you take all this work, you feed it to a deep learning algorithm, and you can get the same results. It might take 1 week to compute, but you get the same, and it will be much faster to compute. So it's a big change in the image processing community, which is, do we have to continue designing features as we used to do, or do we have to use this type of approaches now? And what I just want to mention is that, so if you look, this is a competition where what they asked is the ejection fraction task. So they gave a lot of images, as we see on the top. They gave, for all these training images, the value of ejection fraction. And they said, no, you have to use any learning approach to directly infer this number from the images. And they succeeded very well. So they did this competition. And it's interesting because one of the people who came actually second, if you look at this link, he actually explains all the steps they've been following. And you see that there is a lot of pre-processing. And that's the point I'd like to make. Let's not go too fast here. Of course, this looks very magic. But if you look they had, in this type of images, the first thing they did is detection of the heart. And of course, they extracted region of interest. So now, if we want to look at things like for one same material point, we might still do tracking as a pre-processing step. So this means that we don't have to discard too quickly the good old image processing type. But what we need to think is how to combine it as a pre-processing step, really, because we always will need it. And for instance, there is a big thing that's always hidden under the carpet in all this that's called data augmentation. Because you need a lot of data, and you typically don't have enough data, they try to generate new samples by interpolation. And so that's still something where I think much can be done to improve that and to maybe use other techniques or get the data more specific or work with patches by doing some traditional processing. Okay, so that was the first direction. And the second is, of course, modeling. And that's really what you will see with the talks of Oscar and Maxime. So here, what I just want to mention is when we take an ultrasound exam, we get all these results for flow traces at valves. It's a lot of information. And it has all to be matched in the head of the physician. And what they typically do is that they are testing hypotheses. But doing this integration mentally means it really has to be done by specialists. So that's where we believe that models can do a lot. And it's something we're looking at in the European project, CardioFunction, is to see if models can be an integrator of all the data. And ultrasound is a wonderful example because you do get a lot of data and of very different types. You get shape, motion, velocities, flow. So the question is, how can we integrate all this data and check that things are consistent or not? For instance, if we have a volume curve of the ventricle and the flow traces at the output valve, this should somehow match. There is redundancy in this data. Can we use models to integrate it, detect if it's consistent or not? That's all I had. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. First, again, maybe a little bit of a philosophical question, because what you see is like you show a lot of algorithms, and when you see also when you look at challenges, so you always have like universities competing. Sometimes a company comes in with an algorithm. Rarely a company comes in with a commercial algorithm. But when you look at all these, it's like what you see is the universities come up with very, very complex algorithms, but mostly they take a long time to compute. While in reality, when the company has a product, mostly it's fast. So where does this come? Like when you develop something as a company, it's like which is important? Is the realism important? Are you having magical kind of algorithms where you can do it faster? Or do you just do kind of dirty tricks in order to make it faster? It's like, what's a little bit the philosophy behind it? Like how do you see these algorithms differently in a university and in a company?
Yeah, that's something I saw when moving to a company. So in a university, you don't care a lot about the computation time. And the difference is even, so we are a research lab in Philips, but even at the very beginning of any project, we look at the time it takes for the processing. And if it's too much, we just discard this option. So it means we restrict ourselves to a very reduced set of solutions in comparison to the academia. Then, of course, also when you have a given tool, you try to optimize. So there are a lot of optimization done, and a lot of research is about, how can you get things faster? So this type of optical flow algorithm, we make it faster by not computing the entire displacement field, but only computing for some points of interest. You try to add a lot of these lookup tables that we have seen in the Hof transform to speed things up. So really, it's also the fact that we take a tool that exists and we try to optimize all the steps. And of course, no, I think also something completely new that's appearing is the GPU card. So this is a reasonably priced piece of software that can speed up a lot of things. Of course, it's extremely specific. But progressively, you see that more and more parts of the algorithm are being dealt with GPU. And that's another way to speed up many things. So yeah, it's a lot of design and taking things that are as they are done in academia, but speeding them up, or just cutting this branch. So if you see from the beginning, it will take a lot of time. You just don't start it.
Okay, and partially related to that, maybe a little bit more controversial, is what you see in reality is that then the companies implement this algorithm, and especially when you go to the medical field, it's like, of course, medical doctors use algorithms by the company because often it's integrated in the machine or it's like easy to use in some ways, but these are not necessarily right, they're not necessarily working. And you see sometimes in the field, like when you come with an academic solution from which you know it's superior to what the company does, but just by the fact that the companies have distributed everything within the medical field, it's like you're almost forced to use like a kind of an inferior solution because that's de facto the standard, because it comes from the companies. So it's a little bit like a vicious circle. It's like, do you think that that is like kind of pushed by the companies in a marketing way, or is it just something that the medical doctors are just too much believing in the companies, or there's a little bit like an attitude where validation is not the most important, but maybe the marketing is more important and things like that? How do you see this?
So up to now, marketing has been more important, and also we try to do integrated solution, which typically appeal a lot to the doctors because they have both the acquisition device and the processing in the same environment and in the same workflow. Now, I personally think it will change, but it will change not because of the company, but because of the community of clinicians, also of the academic community. And I think the strain speckle tracking is a good example, because that's an example where people just standing up and say, no, I mean, look, you companies, you are not doing things validated enough, because we are getting very different results. And it cannot be that for the same patient, if we put him in different machines, we get different values. And so that's something coming from the community. They just brought all the companies together. They put them around the table, and they are trying to design these new validation strategies. Of course, it's very slow, because when you put different companies around the table, they don't really want to talk a lot. So that's also a reason why in challenges you see that typically companies are not putting products and it's research versions, and you only have one company, because then they are not too afraid because they are all academics, so it will be all right. But if you get Philips and GE fighting, we are not that comfortable, but it's your job to make us uncomfortable somehow. And I think it's really the job of the community to challenge the manufacturers and to call for more open environments where you could have multi-vendor solutions. So the quantification can be made better if you know a lot about the acquisition, but you can also have generic quantification tools. And now it appears a lot. So actually, Philips is also developing solutions that are multi-vendor. And of course, you have companies that position themselves only on the processing side, and they are directly multi-vendor, like we know a few in cardiac. So I think this is a new trend, and it will develop more and more. But again, it's not the company that's going to push for it. So. But I can trust you for that.
Any other questions? Okay, if not, then we can move on to the next talk.